Now, when you listen to verse 11, and I want now to see what should be the reaction of a Christian to the discipline of God. And there are several reactions you can give. Verse 11, for instance, now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous. And I'm willing to say that it not only doesn't seem to be joyous, it isn't joyous, but grievous. That is the experience. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Now, he wants us to profit by it in order we might be a partaker of his holiness. And I believe, friends, that there's no way in the world to make you a full-grown, and I think that's the main thought in holiness here, a full-grown child of God, living in fellowship with him, except through the discipline of God. Now, down here, why may I say that he disciplines us, and no chastening at the time is fun, but afterward, we're told, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Now, God just doesn't let you be disciplined for no purpose in the world. Just like the man that was in the funny farm, and there was a visitor there one day, and this man was beating himself on the head with a baseball bat. And so the visitor went up to him. He says, why in the world are you hitting yourself on the head with a baseball bat? Well, he says, it feels so good when I quit. Well, my friend, God just doesn't do it to you, so you're going to feel good after it's over. Now, there is a purpose, always a purpose in the discipline of God for you and me today. And my friend, that is something that I want to dwell on now for just a few moments, because I think, again, I'm in a spot where it's very, very important indeed. Now, what is your reaction when God disciplines you? Well, actually, there are four things that are mentioned in this passage of Scripture here, and I'll have to go back and pick up the others that I passed over. Back in verse 5, he says, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. Now, he mentions here, the first thing you can do, you can despise that. That can be your reaction. That is, that means that you treat it lightly, that you get no message from it at all. You become, I would say, a fatalist. Well, everybody has trouble. I'm having trouble. And it's not meaningful to you. You don't get God's message in it at all. You just treat it lightly. You don't recognize the fact that your Heavenly Father's disciplining you in all of this. Now, that's one reaction. You can just absolutely ignore it altogether. And a great many do that. They just take it in stride and say, well, yes, I'm sick. Everybody gets sick. This happens to the human family. And they don't see any purpose in it at all. Now, that's one reaction to it. Then he mentions here something else. Nor faint, you see. And there are those that take that viewpoint. I would say this is the crybaby reaction to it. You begin to cry and say, why did this happen to me? It's not worth living the Christian life. I have served the Lord, and now he's let this happen to me. And you just faint away. And there are a lot of saints that take that attitude. I have been absolutely overwhelmed because I have received, since I've been sick, over 1,000, in fact, several thousand letters from people all over this country and out of this country, throughout the world. And some of these people, they're lots worse off than I am, and some of them made me feel ashamed of myself. They've been on beds of pain for months, and several for years, and they write the sweetest letters, that you've ever seen. And they come from folk. They've got a real victory. I'll be very frank with you. I hear about these meetings where people go and they're healed and they talk about great victories. You want to know where the great victories are being won today? Go to the hospital or go visit some dear saint that's been on the bed for months, years maybe, and listen to them talk. They make me ashamed of myself, I'll tell you that. You can faint, though, but these people don't faint. I tell you, the Lord is strengthening them. Now, he has another message here, and this is a dangerous way because it's so close to that which is true, and that is you can endure it. Well, somebody says, that's what he says, if ye endure chastening. Yes, but these are the super-duper pious saints. I like to speak of them as like the Indian faker. And I think they're a faker too, but a different kind of one. Over in India, he crawls up on a board filled with nails and he lies down. He doesn't have to lie down there, but he does it. And there are a lot of saints today. They accept this in a passive way. Oh, this is of the Lord, and I will endure it. You know, he never asked you to take that pessimistic, that super pious attitude toward your trouble. Why don't you go to him and ask him, Lord, why did you send this to me? There's a lesson here, and I want to learn the lesson. And not accept it in that passive manner. And I've had a few letters like that. Oh, this is something that I've endured, and I'll just go on enduring it, you know, in a passive way and complaining all the time. Now, here is the fourth one, and he mentions that here in verse 11. He says, nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceful fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Now, you can be exercised by it. Did you ever take setting up exercises? I played golf on a golf course where there's a man I've got more or less acquainted with him. He jogs around the course while I play golf, and he does that to lose weight. He is inclined to be a little chubby, and so he's doing that to lose weight. He exercises, you see. Now, I've thought of that in recent days. Are you exercised when you get in trouble, when you have to suffer, when your problem comes to you, even when an enemy comes across your pathway? Have you ever stopped to ask God, why in the world did you let that fellow come across my pathway? And you know God does it for a purpose. God does all these things for a purpose. And the thing to do is to be exercised by. Paul said that he wanted to keep under his body. He wanted to exercise because he didn't want to come before God's presence someday and be disapproved. My friend, I don't care where you are, who you are, it's time you're taking your setting up exercises. And I mean by that the kind of exercises that are going to put you in a position where you don't go like verse 12, wherefore lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees. Don't walk around through life as a Christian complaining all the time. I used to have a friend that I learned to quit asking him how he felt because he always told me how he felt, and it took him 15 minutes to tell you how he felt, and I've never met him when he ever felt good, you see. Going around all the time with his hands which hang down and his feeble knees. May I say to you, my friend, somebody's watching you. How do you endure the trouble that comes to you? Do you endure it by being exercised by it? That's the important way, and that's the way we are to endure it. We'd say, my Heavenly Father, he's chastening me, and there's a purpose in it. I want to learn the lesson. We start, you're setting up exercises. One, two, three. One, two, three. Lord, I'd like to know why I'm suffering this way. Now, notice, he says, make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. And I'll be very frank with you, I've never been quite clear just what he meant by this. Make straight paths for your feet, are you to walk the straight path that the weak saint might follow in your footsteps? Or are you to walk the straight path so that you don't get in the habit of limping through life? And there are a lot of lame brain Christians today. They complain, they criticize, and they're no witness for God at all, and yet they appear very super pious. Now, he continues on here, follow peace with all men. Be encouraged and be at peace with all men. That is, with all that you can be at peace, because some people just won't be at peace. And holiness, follow peace with all men. That is, with all Christian men. Make this a big cross-country race that we're in today, where a lot of us are running the Christian life today. And holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Now, if that means that I've got to produce holiness, then I'm going to give up, because I don't have any. But the peace that I've got came through the blood of Christ. Being justified by faith, I have peace with God. And if I got any holiness, he's been made unto me righteousness, and he is my righteousness, and that's what I'm expecting to see God. If I get in his presence, it'll be just because Christ died for me. And that's encouraging, friends. That makes